Then how you can break up that in simple form so that you can compute the limit of that sequence. So ultimate aim would be what? You have to compute the limit of a sequence if that sequence is having a limit. So you need to compute it. So that process we will talk in detail. And this one is lecture number 9. And here we will talk about in detail how to compute a sequence of limit of a sequence, whether that sequence is complicated or not. Don't worry about that. Definitely, if you are going in a right direction, you will be able to compute limit of a sequence. So that thing we will discuss in detail. So coming to outline of today's lecture, I would like to discuss about first three important laws of limit. That means three law that what I told initially, well-defined result. It would be based on epsilon k game, and we will apply that in order to find limit of a sequence, whether that one is a complicated or simple. Then also we will see one interesting application of L'Hopital rule. So that one is also playing very important role. And in plus two, you might have already gone through L'Hopital rule. Definitely, I will discuss it again when we will cover differentiability. It is dealing with differentiability of the function. So that's why we will discuss in that segment as well regarding detail of how it is happening and what are the various form of L'Hopital rule. So that thing we will discuss in detail. And after that, I will talk about very interesting kind of one more result that we are calling it the monotone convergence theorem for sequences. And based on this, how we can establish convergency or divergency of a sequence, and if a sequence happens to be convergent, then how we can find limit of that sequence. So those things we will see it here. After that, if time permit, then we will discuss about a few more examples which would be based on above two things. Okay, so various examples. So here definitely when I mention further examples, complicated kind of sequences would come there, and here it would be not easy to find limit of those sequences. But if you proceed in a very algorithmic way, systematic way, you will be able to find limit of those sequences. If provided limit exists, then definitely you will be able to find. So coming to first part, that three important laws of limit, and including there would be one more extra that we are calling it L'Hopital rule. That rule also it will come here in order to find limit of a sequence. So all these are computational technique. Here I'm not going to prove that one number would be limit of a sequence. Here we are trying to find limit of a sequence. So that is the computational technique what we are calling it here in order to find limit of a sequence. So what are those theorem? First theorem, everyone might be aware of that. Generally we are calling it sandwich theorem. That means if you are having a sequence which is sandwiched between two previous sequence y n and z n. Suppose x n is a sequence which has been sandwiched between y n and z n, and we know the limit of y n and z n. What are the limit of y n is l, and limit of z n is also L. Then in that case, it is very much easy to prove that limit of the sandwiched sequence would be also L, because it is tracing from the both side. And if you try to see the proof, then proof would be very simple, that easily we know that this sequence yn is convergent. So easily we can say that there would be one epsilon with respect to that there exists a case so that yn modulus absolute value of yn minus L, it would be less than epsilon. Okay, and likewise also you can prove that absolute value of zn minus L would be less than epsilon. Better take it epsilon by 2, or if epsilon there would be no any issue. It would be epsilon. Now what do you want to prove? You want to prove that now sequence xn, it is sandwiched between these two. So you are willing to prove that absolute value of xn minus L, it would be also less than some epsilon. That you want to prove that. So how you can prove that? This proof is very much easy to prove. You can take it as a homework, apply triangle inequality. From that easily you can prove this result. What you for that in order to apply triangle inequality, definitely it would be less than twice of epsilon or some function of epsilon. So I am calling it epsilon 1, epsilon. So here what you do, apply this inequality, one inequality is this one. Another inequality that you know about triangle inequality, if you are taking two real number, then sum of absolute value of sum of these two real number would be less than sum of absolute values. So these two criteria. So apply these two inequality, that there are how many inequality? One is this one, another one is this one, another one is this one. So call it two. Okay. Call it three. And there is triangle inequality, fourth one. So apply these inequality as a hint, and you will see that sequence xn is converging to L. Easy to prove. Take this one as a homework. You can try, just play with epsilon k again, and you will see that you will get convergence of limit, convergence of sequence xn. That means L would be also limit of the sequence xn. Okay, so that is the sandwich theorem proof. I had already discussed. You can try as a homework. I won't go in detail. So for example, I will take few sequences. So suppose I am taking one sequence and we are defining nth term by ratio of sine nx divided by n square. So how we can we say that how we can find the limit of the sequence? Anyone? Does it satisfy sandwich theorem? Anyone? How you can find applying sandwich theorem? Anyone? Just am I audible or not? How you can find limit of this sequence using sandwich theorem? Okay. Anyone just try to attempt it? It is very much simple that we know that sine function happens to be a bounded function, and the value of sine is what? It lies between minus 1 and 1. So that's why we can say that value of sine n, it would lie between minus 1 and 1. Okay. And after that, what you do? You divide throughout by n square. Okay, what does it mean? That it simply say that it implies that our sequence xn, given sequence xn, lies between what? Minus 1 by n square and n by 1 by n square. 1 by n square. So simply, and what we know, if n tends to infinity, it will approach to 0, and this one will also approach to 0 when n tends to infinity. That's why xn would also approach to 0 due to sandwich theorem, this theorem. So how it is coming? You can mention it here. It is coming with respect to sandwich theorem. Easily you can establish that. Likewise, if I ask question, what would be limit of this one? Okay, one, very nice. So you can see how it is happening, how sandwich theorem is coming here. You can see it easily that limit would be what? We know that limit of interior term, it would be 0, and hence cosine of 0 is what? 1. So that's why this sequence would approach to 1. So it is just these two are application of sandwich theorem. And there are various sequences there. You can directly find the limit of the sequence with the help of sandwich theorem. It is coming under the sandwich theorem category. Okay, so directly we are able to compute. Now this one is the first theorem. Second theorem, it is talking about that if you are having a sequence whose limit is x, then this one simply implies that if you take modulus of each term of the sequence, then the corresponding sequence, this one simply you can say that it is a new sequence yn. How you are getting yn? Taking absolute value of the xn, each xn. So yn. So if xn is converging to x, that means x is the limit of this sequence, then where would converge yn? That modulus of n, it will converge to modulus of x. Very simple proof. If someone is willing to see the proof, then proof is coming again from triangle inequality. We know that this xn is converging to x. That's why for every epsilon there would be one k, such that for n greater than or equal to k, this mod absolute value would be less than epsilon, and hence we can say that this one is directly coming from triangle inequality, and hence we can say that this quantity would be less than epsilon. That means modulus of xn is converging to modulus of x. It is converging. That modulus of x is the limit of this sequence, absolute value sequence. Okay, and this proof is simply, it is directly coming from triangle's inequality. Triangle, what you do here, triangle inequality, you know that I had already discussed few consequences of triangle inequality, like suppose x, how you can write it, x, you can write it x minus a plus a. So apply triangle inequality over modulus of x. So modulus of x would be what? Modulus of x minus y plus y, and here simply treat this one as a and this one is b, and from the triangle inequality we know that as absolute value of a plus b is less than equal to sum of corresponding absolute value. That means absolute value of x minus y plus absolute value of y. So that criteria is coming. So from here, you what we further, if you try to simplify it, then what you are getting, you to bring this absolute value of y left hand side, then you will observe that absolute value of x minus absolute value of y is less than equal to absolute value of x minus y easily. And we know that if we change x by y, what will happen? If we change x by y, we will get here absolute value of y minus absolute value of x less than equal to y minus x, and x minus y both are same. So we can simply write absolute value of y minus x. It is y because it is under the absolute value. That's way. And if you take common minus y, then these two, combining these two, what it will imply? It will imply, simply it will imply, if you combine these two, it will simply imply that modulus of difference of modulus of x and y, it would be less than equal to modulus of x minus y. Just one characterization of what consequences of triangle inequality from there. So that's why I had written this result. It is just coming from there. So proof is very simple. So but this result it looks very simple, but it is having a really interesting utilization. Yes. This one is very simple. You can take it, call it one. Okay. Here, it is clear to you. And this one is clear to you. So I am writing another form of the second inequality. So how I am writing? I am taking minus common. So if I take minus common, then what does it become? It becomes minus of modulus of x minus modulus of y. This quantity would be less than equal to x minus modulus of x minus y. And further, what I will do, I will multiply minus with both, minus 1 with both sides. Then definitely what will happen, we will get here minus of negative of absolute value of x minus y would be less than difference of absolute value of x and absolute value of y. Is it clear? Call it. So this one is this one is nothing, just I have written inequality 2 in a different 4. So combining, so that's why I'm naming this again 2. So combining 1 and 2, what you will get? You see that this difference of modulus, modulus of x minus modulus of x minus modulus of y, it lies between where negative of x minus modulus of x minus y and yeah. So simply you can write it like this way. You got now that result I had discussed several time that what is meaning of modulus of x less than epsilon. It simply implies and implied by implication. It says that x lies between negative epsilon. Yeah, it is just the consequences of that. So that's where I put it. I think it might be clear to everyone. So I am going forward. This one is really interesting, and if someone is willing to see the proof again, I will say that very easy. Proof is very easy again based on epsilon k game. Just play epsilon k game, then proof you will see easily. But this theorem is important in order to find limit of a sequence. So that's why in order to compute a sequence, limit of a sequence. Okay. So what you do here? If you take a sequence xn. It happens to be sequence of positive real number. That means each xn is greater than equal to 0. Each xn is greater than equal to 0. Okay, sequence of positive real number. And now find the limit of ratio of any two conjugated term. Ratio that what is happening, that future term and you call xn is present, then xn plus 1 would be next feature, just next feature. So take ratio of that. And if this ratio is a fixed number L, if the you are getting another sequence, you can call this sequence yn. Yn is the ratio of two conjugated term. That means xn plus 1. You can easily define this one. There is no issue. If there is a feasibility to define this ratio, then you can define and find the limit of yn. If limit of yn is a number L. And what is happening that if this number L is less than 1, then easily you can guarantee that the corresponding sequence of positive real number, it is going to converge to 0. It is going to converge to 0. That is the implication what I would like to say, that easily you will get this all limit of that sequence what it would be. So example I have taken here, simply take a sequence Rn. So I had already proved that Rn is converging to 0 when R lies between 0 to 1. So that concept I had already proved, that everyone might have already seen that this, but I haven't proved the part of when R lies between minus 1 to 0, that segment I haven't proved it. So in order to see that proof, just apply 3 and this one, call it, this one is result 3 and this one is called result 2. So again you will get alternative proof of this alternative way to find limit of this one. One, what is the alternative? We know that here even if you just consider, focus on this part, what is happening, that what would be y ratio of two conjugate term. So just define ratio of two conjugate term here like this way. R two conjugate term like x, we are denoting it by this sequence, suppose xn. So xn plus 1 divided by xn, what it would be? It would be equal to r to the power n plus 1 divided by r to the power n. and if you simplify, the result is equal to r. And yeah, when you take limit n tends to infinity, where it will converge? It is a fixed number, it is just independent of n. So again, if you talk about this one is a sequence, so yn as a ratio of two consecutive term of the sequence xn, then it is again fixed to converging to r. That one is a fixed number and r is less than 0, sorry, less than 1, not less than 0, it is less than 1. So easily you can claim that this sequence xn or xn equal to r to the power n is converging to 0. Easily you can prove that. Second part, if you talk about r lies between minus 1 to 0, then what will happen that so in that case what would be your sequence? Your sequence is taking simply, you can say that if it is between minus 1 to r, then definitely you can say that r is what? It is a negative number, so represent this one as a minus b. B is a positive number here. B is a positive number. So what would be xn? It would be r to the power n, and hence you can write this one as minus 1 to the power n into b to the power n, and use the result 2. We had already seen that it will converge to 0 when r is lies between minus 1 to 1. In that case b will be between 0 to 1. Yeah, it might be clear to everyone. Okay, so in that perspective you can say that if xn is converging to 0, then modulus of xn is also converging to 0. So apply that concept, easily you will get the result. So that's why these three are very fundamental result theorems which is helping to compute the directly it is computing the limit. Okay, now we will go to talk about another interesting kind of result that we are calling it L'Hopital rule. It is really interesting from various perspective. Definitely it is dealing with differentiable function, and here we are just discussing about what we call it sequences, and those are defined at discrete point, not continuous point. So that's way how you will find it application of this one. So first we have to recall what is L'Hopital rule. So suppose we are having two functions f and g, and both are differentiable in some neighborhood of a given point a, and these two functions may not be differentiable at a, but it is differentiable in some neighborhood of a. So that kind of neighborhood generally we are calling it dilated kind of neighborhood. Why we are saying like this way? Anyone? How we define differentiability of a function at a point? I will discuss there in segment, but you just recall differentiability of function. Suppose you are at a, we are not going to talk about left hand derivative, right hand derivative. I am just defining derivative by first principle. Yeah, we define it limit a tends to a difference of f of x and f of a divided by x minus a. So yeah, so when we are defining limit of a this kind of limit, what kind of limit it is here? It is, you can easily see that here there in denominator there is an involvement of x minus a. So that's why we sometimes we are saying that function may not be okay. What we do, we can't take x equal to, we can't simply directly, we can't put x equal to a here. We have to simplify, then we will put, otherwise there would be issue. 1 by infinity form would be here. So after simplification, definitely simplified form will not contain any term in the denominator, then that's why we are getting derivative of that. But here at the first glance we observe that there is a term x minus a in the denominator, that's why we are putting this kind of condition. Okay, and later you will get a lot of explanation regarding that. So this function, these two function f and g are both differentiable, and we are taking that function is vanishing at a. Apart from that, the derivative of the function, first derivative, suppose first derivative of the function depends upon what the L Hopital is not stopped up to first derivative. It may go further and further. Suppose first derivative of the denominator function g is non-zero except maybe a itself. It is non-zero in the neighborhood of a. Simply you can say that it is non-zero in the neighborhood of a, then what will happen? So if you are going to find limit of these rational function or ratio of these two function, then directly, because we know that if you are trying to find limit at a and a f is vanishing at a, g is also vanishing at a, so it is one kind of 0 by 0 form, that we are calling it indeterminate form. Okay, so simply we can't calculate that easily, so we have to apply that differentiality concept, and that Taylor's polynomial of that will come, and if you simplify, then this limit is equal to just finding the limit of the ratio of corresponding derivative. If provided that the first derivative of g is non-zero. Okay, if suppose it is zero, then you will go for the higher derivative. You have to keep on proceeding. So that is the L Hopital rule, what we are calling it. It is really interesting to calculate limit of a ratio of two functions. Ratio of two functions. That's where we will apply this concept in order to get the limit of. And remember that how we are defining. So focus on here a. In this small neighborhood of a, function must be differentiable. But this function may or may not be differentiable at a, but in the small neighborhood of this one, function must be differentiable. So that's where we are trying to find. So that's where we are able to find limit of any ratio of two function in the neighborhood of infinity. We know that infinity is not a real number. And but if you are having a function which is having what? Undeterminate form. So there are various undeterminate forms, 0 by 0, infinity by infinity, all these are. So one thing I had already discussed about relation of what neighborhood of infinity, and neighborhood of infinity is very much associated with neighborhood of zero as well. So like if what I had told that neighborhood of infinity generally we denote it by x greater than 1 by epsilon, for a given epsilon x greater than 1 by epsilon, and it would be equivalent to say that and implied by 1 by x less than epsilon, that means right neighborhood of zero. So if you are defining, suppose you are going up to infinity, it would be somewhere after this. So this one is the left neighborhood of infinity. We are calling it here. This point would be, you can call it 1 by epsilon, and every x which is greater than 1 by epsilon that falls in the neighborhood of infinity, then it is equivalent to say that, suppose this one is point is zero, say that it falls in the right neighborhood of, here in term of 1 by x, the reciprocal term would fall in right neighborhood of 0. So this here it would be epsilon. 0 plus epsilon, so epsilon. So right neighborhood. If x is falling in this left neighborhood of infinity, then 1 by x will fall in right neighborhood of 0. Right epsilon neighborhood of 0. Both this one is the epsilon neighborhood of infinity, this one is the epsilon neighborhood of 0. You can call it like this way. N epsilon 0, and this one you can call it n epsilon infinity. So that correspondence we had already seen that. So that's why same concept is applicable to this one as well. So here that if it is 0 by 0, fine. If it is infinity by infinity, fine. You can always apply L Hopital rule. So I will take benefit of this one in order to calculate the limit of few sequences. So if you are having a sequence log n by n. So we know that here a is infinity, infinity. So if you talk about log x, so corresponding function, this one is a sequence describe and define over just natural numbers. Okay, so we can take a continuous form of this one. What it would be? Log x divided by x, and we know that log x in the neighborhood of infinity it is taking very high value, and in the neighborhood of infinity it is also differentiable. Log x is very nice and differentiable, and x is also differentiable, and when x is approaching to infinity, this one is going to approach to infinity, this one is also going to approach infinity. So it is somewhat in the neighborhood of infinity. You can say that it is the form of infinity by infinity. So it is legitimate to apply L'Hopital rule. So what you do, so if you are finding limit of this one, then what would when x tends to infinity, it will converge to derivative of this ratio of corresponding derivative. So what is the derivative of log x? It would be 1 by x, and derivative of x would be 1. So when you talk about, and it is what? It is approaching to 0 as x is approaching to infinity, and n plus of x take n, and hence what we observe that limit of this sequence log n divided by n is equal to 0. So we directly compute able to compute the limit of this sequence using L'Hopital rule, and it is coming like this way. Now next interesting kind of sequence is coming here, 1 plus k by n to the power n. So if you are willing to calculate limit of this sequence, then what you do, easily you can express this limit like this way. Anyone would like to comment how these things are coming? Don't remember the formula, how it is coming? Anyone? If you don't know, just easily say that I don't know, then definitely I will describe it how it is coming. So here simply x, nth term is what? You can write it, nth term is 1 plus k by n to the power n. So what you do, take log both sides. If you are taking log both sides, so it becomes what? N time log of 1 plus k by n, bracket close. Okay, what you do from the definition of log here, base by default we are taking it e. If nothing is given mentioned about base, then by default you can take base would be e. So we know from the definition of logarithmic function, what does it say? So if you are defining log x equal to y, then what does it mean with base e? Then it is defined from the definition of logarithmic, it would say x is equal to e to the power y. And further, if you take logarithmic both sides, you will get the previous result. That is the definition of, so that's your exponential function and logarithmic function, both are inverse to each other. Generally we are mirror image with respect to y equals to x. Both are mirror image to each other with respect to y equal to x. Okay, so from the same concept you can talk about xn would be what here? Would be exponential e to the power, or exponential generally we write. There are many terms, so that's why I had written here exponential. So e to the power n time log 1 plus k by n. So from there it is coming. So this one is just another representation of nth term. Again, this exponential function is continuous in nature, so limit can go inside the exponential due to continuity. Continuity and limit both exchange each other. Yes. K by n. I have taken here 1 plus k by n. I haven't simplified it. It is just I am taking here both side. I am taking log both sides. So that's where here log x n and here n something to the if you are applying. So this quantity call it a. This quantity call it a. So what would be log of a n? It would be okay. Clear? So just you can find here. Now here you are willing to find any doubt? There would be question here. How to find this limit? How to find this limit? There would be question. So in order to find this limit, again apply L'Hopital rule. How? So you have to convert that in that form. So what kind of form? We observe it here. If you try to, So it convert this was this argument of exponential. Call it argument exponent with limit like this way log of 1 plus k by n. Divided by 1 by n, and when n goes to infinity, this would approach to infinity, and this would this would approach to 0, and this would approach to 0. So it is 0 by 0 form. It is 0 by 0 form. This form, undetermined form, and n is approaching to infinity, and we know that log 1 plus if you replace it by x, 1 plus x is a very nice function. It is differentiable. Differentiable in the neighborhood of infinity, 1 by x is also differentiable in the neighborhood of infinity. Is going what is the plot of 1 by infinity? 1 by x, it is going something like this way. So it is approaching to 0, and that means if you talk about infinity somewhere here, the function 1 by x is differentiable, log 1 by 1 plus 1 by x is also differentiable. So very nice, both denominator and numerator are differentiable function in the neighborhood of infinity. So we can talk about differentiability of this one. So if you differentiate, so here just you have to apply your chain rule. So first consider this one 1 plus k by n as argument and differentiate with respect to that. Then what you will get? You will get it here. There is a space crunch, so I will talk somewhere else. So I am talking here. So if you differentiate this function with respect to first argument, then later you will differentiate that argument with respect to actual value. So if you differentiate with first argument, it would be just 1 by 1 plus k by n. Then you have to differentiate 1 plus k by n with respect to n. So that's where you will get minus k by n square. And denominator also you need to differentiate with respect to n. So that's where here you will get minus 1 by n square. So n square, you are taking limit n tends to infinity. That's why this cancellation are feasible. There is no issue because n is not equal to infinity. That's why you are able to cancel these two. And if you simplify, where does it go? Minus will cancel out. Here minus in numerator, minus in denominator, it will cancel out. Only we will have what? We will have plus k. Okay, plus k would come here. This k will come because this k will vanish. When n tends to infinity, k by n will approach to 0. So we will have just plus k. So that's where exponential of k is coming, and e to the power k. All you got it through L'Hopital rule and other concept. Okay, so do we have time? We are having 2 more minutes. So I will discuss monotone convergence theorem, and probably you will find a lot of application of this theorem. And later we will start series as I mentioned. So what does monotone convergence theorem says? It says that if you are having a bounded sequence, that means each term of the sequence is bounded. That means bounded above. Bounded means bounded above. That concept I had already mentioned that, and bounded below as well. Both. That means lies between two fixed real number for every n natural number. Then we say that sequence is a bounded sequence. Apart from that, if it is monotone. That means monotonically increasing or monotonically decreasing. That means monotonically increasing means the feature term n plus 1, a n plus 1 would be greater than equal to a n for every n. Okay, this one is increasing. So increasing, I will denote its sign by vertical arrow. And decreasing, what is meaning of decreasing? If it is a n plus 1 is less than equal to an. So for every n, then that sequence we are calling it monotonically decreasing, lower vertical. Okay. Downward arrow we denoted that. So if a sequence is bounded, that means satisfy this condition, and monotone, that means either this condition or call it 2-2 alternative one or D condition, either monotonically increasing or decreasing, then we say that sequence will definitely converge to a real number x, guaranteed. If it is monotonic and bounded, then guaranteed it will be convergent. So just I have elaborated that in a further way. I have broken this theorem again. If sequence is bounded and monotonically increasing, then where does it converge? It will converge to supremum of the range of the sequence. If it is bounded and monotonically increasing, that means this side, monotonically increasing, then the corresponding sequence will converge to supremum of the range of the sequence. And another way, if sequence is bounded and monotonically decreasing, then where that sequence will converge? That sequence will converge to infimum of the range. Infimum of the range. When the sequence is monotonically decreasing and bounded, then it will converge. Definitely convergence is guaranteed. So one simplest example I am taking, not simplest, it might be complicated. So if you are defining a sequence like this way, xn is containing itself n number of terms. So xn is defined by this way, 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 plus up to 1 by n. And we are talking about whether this sequence is converging or not. So we have to see that whether this sequence is bound monotone or not. Later we will see that whether this sequence is bounded or not. So first we see that establish the monotonicity. Monotonicity is very much clear. We can easily see that if you take just a feature term xn plus 1, so it would be 1 plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 3 plus up to 1 by n plus 1 by n plus 1. So if you focus on these n number of terms, first n terms, what is this? These are just talking about xn, defining xn. So simply you can say that xn plus 1 is nothing, just it is equal to xn plus 1 additional positive term, 1 by n plus 1. So easily it says that xn plus 1 is greater than equal to xn. So simply we can say that this sequence is monotonically increasing. It is already proved it is monotonically increasing. Now next we try to establish whether it is bounded or not. So suppose come up with one x to n, 2 to the power n terms, come up with this term, and if you try to find this term and simplify, you will see that this x to n 2 to the power n term, it would be greater than 1 plus n by 2. What does it say? That means simply we observe that this term is greater than 1 plus n by 2. That means here if you focus this part, this sequence itself is diverging to infinity when n tends to infinity. It is n 1 plus n by 2. So it will, and simply it will imply that the corresponding sequence xn is divergent. Why? Because it is unbounded. It is unbounded, and hence we can say that this sequence is divergent, and limit of this sequence would be positive infinity. That is meaning of divergent. So this sequence is divergent. So other thing we will discuss in next class, and probably next class we will start series, and within few class we will finish series. After that we will start limit continuity, differentiability, all those will come together.